So we are live from lockdown with Isaac Chamberlain. How you
doing?
You look happy.
Bruh, this is crazy, man. It's crazy times, but, you know, I'm just happy that I'm still being able to train. Not just sit at home all day. I've been training, playing PlayStation, Call of Duty.
How are you training? Like, where are you training? What sort of setup have you got at the moment?
My friend has a private boxing gym, and you know, I'm going there every other day. I bought an exercise bike, like a watt bike, that I'm gonna go on. I'm been using 1 hour every day, you know, or 1 hour every other day. And I've been doing like sit-ups. I've been setting challenges, like trying to get up to 3,000 sit-ups a day. So 1,000 in the morning, 1,000 afternoon, 1,000. I'm just trying to do little things to keep my mind occupied. I'm watching a lot of, I'm focusing a lot on the basics and training and stuff. And I've just been going through tactics and stuff. I've been speaking to Angel as well, just going through tactics of different boxes to implement that, like, with my footwork and my shoulders and stuff like that.
So is the plan to work with Angel when it all resumes, or Jorge, or both, or what's the plan there?
Basically, the plan is, you know, before I was out in Miami a whole lot, but because of this pandemic and stuff, you know, things are a bit crazy. So I've been speaking to Angel, and obviously he has the Loughborough University set up, and I think that's the best thing any fighter could ever ask for, because, you know, because of the training facilities and the way I can be able to push myself and push my body, you know, to the best shape possible with Loughborough University. So I definitely think that that will be the way going forward, you know. And Angel knows me a lot more than the other coaches, and we have that bond. And, you know, all the other times where we had like little mishaps with fights and stuff, he's been there working on my craft. So the person that should be able to benefit from the results of the work that we've put in should be him instead of anyone else.
You talked about mishaps with fights. You've been out of the ring for 18 months now. You were supposed to come back with two fights in the space of a month on terrestrial television, which would have been amazing. Yeah. And then the pandemic hit. You must be one of the most unlucky boxers going on at the moment.
Bruh, you know, it is unlucky, but you have to look at it from a different perspective. This is not just affecting me. You know, I can only control the things that I can control. You know, there's other people dying. There's other people, you know, that are really sick. So I should be fortunate. You know, I shouldn't even be complaining. You know, I'm just having to look at it from a different view. Of course, I'm upset, you know, the boxing and, you know, things happen. But this is just a part of life. It just knows that when I come back, I'm going to be a lot better. I'm going to be a lot more prepared. I just have to look at it from a different perspective and a different point of view. I'm trying to be very, very positive about everything. You know, I'm trying to be positive about the situation and what's happening around me, but it's going to pay off.
Is it kind of reassuring in a sense that you have got that deal with a terrestrial television promoter, so you know that when you do come back and all this ends, you're in a good position?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Definitely. It's good because I have a great relationship with Mick, Michael Sal as well, Richard Maynard, you know, everybody, they're really, really good people. You know, I can speak to them about anything, and their focus is on me being a great champion in the future and a pay-per-view star. And I believe I can do that. I definitely believe I can do that. You know, it's just about coming back and really showing what I'm about and the dedication and the discipline that I've been putting on, that I've been working on myself. Like, I've been working so hard in the gym. You know, I've been working extremely hard in the gym. Even when there was no fight, I was drilling myself, making sure I'm getting the right work in and things like that. So I just can't wait to get back.
And when you do get back, what sort of route do you want to take? Do you want to go through the traditional, you know, British, European before a world title, or are you looking to get maybe a fringe strap from one of the governing sanctioning bodies and move in that direction?
I think because obviously the one goal is to be WBC world champion, so we're going for any strap that takes me closest to the WBC world title. If it's the WBC international belt, I don't know if he has. I think Tommy McCarthy has it. Then we'll go for him and we'll take him out. You know, so what we're doing is we're just working any way to that WBC strap, and then we go from there and we just keep working and keep working. And that's my motivation. My motivation is just to get that WBC strap. You know, nothing else matters at the moment, just to work and work extremely hard and to get that. And I have the great support and the great backing of Mick and Michael that and Matt Hamilton as well, that they really invested in me. You know, so, and it feels really good to have those people behind me and the people at Channel 5 as well.
And you mentioned the kind of world scene as it stands at Cruiserweight. We've got the World Boxing Super Series final at some point when it gets rescheduled. It's already been postponed twice, I think, now, unfortunately. Dorticos and Breedis. What do you make of that fight? And have you kind of crossed swords with either of those guys in the gym or anything?
Yeah. We were supposed to be sparring Dorticos. I sparred one of his guys before when he came in, but he was sick. I sparred one of his guys. I dealt with him, like, because obviously I came to that spar, like, with, because I know they're not coming to play, so I'm not coming here to play. I came all the way from London. Do you know what I mean? So they're probably thinking, who's this young 25-year-old black boy coming here trying to do something? Da, 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 da. So I came there and I gave it to them. I was busting people up. Do you know what I mean? So, and then after that, they were just like, they was kept saying, oh, Dorticos ain't training today, or Dorticos is... So I just started to realize maybe they're making excuses, because at that type of camp, like near the last few stages of camp, maybe he wants sparring partners that's just going to build his confidence that he can beat up. He doesn't want no one that's going to like present a fuck him up.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, boy, and maybe not. Maybe he actually had excuses, but listen, I was ready. I was ready to go for him. Do you know what I mean? And to see how I can be at that level. Because I've already sparred guys like Usyk, Joshua, Wilder, Dylan, all of them. You know, I've sparred these top guys. So I know I can handle myself. You know, Mike Perez, Matias Mastodat. Like, and I've been given work. You know, it's not like it's just been luck. I've been given work for a while. So I know that, I know what it takes. I know I have what it takes to be a great champion. You know, because I went all the way out of my comfort zone, you know, by myself in Miami training, you know, so I know what it's like. So, and I definitely matched their standards and even above.
Who do you fancy in that fight, Breedis and Dorticos?
I don't really know. I think Breedis because of his pace. Dorticos is good, but he has great power and leverage with his punches. But he's one of those 1-2 guys. He don't really throw body shots. He's quite open. He's quite basic with it as well. So, you know, if Breedis can counter his jab, because he kind of throws the jab just to set up the 1-2. If Breedis can counter his jab and come with the combination that he does, especially in the later rounds, he gets his second win and he comes stronger. I definitely think he can win or even come with a late stoppage. But if Dorticos catches him early, then, you know, and he walks into a right hand or something, it depends how Breedis can defend the right hand and how he can slip and adjust to Dorticos' straight punches.
And what about your old rival, Lawrence Okolie, challenging for the WBO belt held by Krzysztof Glowacki? That's obviously, again, been delayed, but do you think he can get the job done?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Okolie is he's big enough and he's strong enough to do that. But obviously, it's him dealing with Glowacki's southpaw style. You know, Glowacki's southpaw style, because he obviously had some early frustrations with Wadi with his southpaw style, you know, but then he got Wadi out of there. But what is him dealing with Glowacki's southpaw style and Glowacki's counters, because he waits for him to get the counter, but and Okolie kind of leans back a little bit. So if Okolie has his range has Glowacki's range figured out, then he'll win. But I don't know, it's a pick and fight.
And you mentioned some of the top names that you've sparred earlier. Just pick out a couple of them for us that you feel you've learned the most from sparring against.
Probably from Usyk.
Okay.
You know, I probably learned the most from Usyk, you know, because after sparring, we used to talk a lot. I used to try and pick his mind. You know, we'll spar on Monday and I'll do really well. And then he'll ask me and then I'll, like, for example, if I sparred on Monday and I didn't do so good, yeah, I would ask him and then he'll be like, yeah, you need to do this, you need to do that. And on Wednesday, when we spar and it's very, very competitive, I'll ask him and he'll be like, yeah, that's good. And he won't tell me nothing else anymore. because he knows that I'm learning and I'm picking things and I'm getting better and better. So it's one of those things where, you know, with Usyk, you know, I learned a lot, and I learned a lot from his coach as well. You know, I was practicing a lot of different things from his coach that he was teaching. I would watch him and I'll study all of these guys, even how their camps are, even how they think, even their body language, even the way they are before and after the gym. And I was studying absolutely everything, and I was putting everything into my head. You know, just the lifestyle of a champion, not just them being in the ring. How they're warming up, how they're stretching, how they're relaxing, what music they listen to, everything.
What music they listen to? Does that help in any way? And can you tell us any of the?
No, obviously you can tell a lot of how somebody is psychologically by the music that they listen to. You know, by the music they listen to, and at what time or what's happening, what he uses to get himself motivated or hyped up or whatever. But he's he doesn't speak much. You know, Usyk is just like, yes, good, yes, little bit of this, little bit of this. You know, that's how he speaks. So he's kind of laid back. He's kind of laid back. That's why his style is a bit laid back as well. But he works. Do you know what I mean? So when you're relaxed and laid back, but you're working, you have enough oxygen to go through your bodies to do the 10 rounds and the 12 rounds that you're sparring.
Do you feel in any of your pro fights so far you've ever reproduced the form that you've shown in sparring some of these top fighters?
Yeah, but because obviously the way my fights have been, you know, sometimes it's been a bit a while before I fought, or there might be some rust, or like you can't really tell. But I think now, because there's a schedule now, you know, before there wasn't really a schedule. It was like, you fight this person this time, I wouldn't even know, like whatever. And I'll just stay in the gym. But now with Mick, there's a schedule. Okay, we have this many shows this time, and we're going to get this show, and we're going to fight here and all of that. So now we can map everything, you know, we can map everything around how we're going to do the camp and how we're going to train. And I'm definitely going to benefit from that as well.
The fact that pretty much everyone I've spoken to that you've worked with, either trained you or sparred with you, has said how much talent and your work ethic and everything else, does that kind of keep you going when you're waiting ages for fights or when things are going wrong? Do you always kind of go back to that and say the ability's there clearly?
No, but I just think it's not really a motivation thing. It's just a habit. You know, I've been doing this for long enough and it's my job. You know, I've made a lot of money from boxing. Thank God that I made a whole lot of money from boxing that most prospects haven't. Do you know what I mean? You know, from endorsements, from big fights that I had. And I'm definitely grateful for that. But it's just about a habit now. You know, most people, they wake up, they brush their teeth. Me, I wake up, I'll go running. I'll brush my teeth too, but, you know, I'll go. that's just how
they look very white from here, to be fair.
Well, that's what you do. You know, it's just your job. That's what you're supposed to do. So I don't need no congratulations for doing what I'm supposed to do. I don't need no congratulations for training while I'm in quarantine, because this is my job. I'm supposed to do this type of stuff if I want to be a champion.
And you never doubt yourself, even if you've been out the ring for ages or you have a setback. You've always got that kind of innate self-confidence.
No, because you have to use everything as motivation, because I've been out the ring, most people would have quit, would have been like, you know what, let me just go do something else. I've been out the ring over there. But I've grafted day in and day out, and I've kept going, and I've kept going, and I've kept going, and I haven't stopped, you know. And that's what pushes me on. That's what edges me on. And that's what's like, yeah, this is what I need to do. So I'm not going to quit.
Once all this is over, or when lockdown's lifted at least, how much notice are you going to need to get in the ring? Being out for this long,
not much.
You're gagging to get
going. Not much notice. Well, you know, with Michael and Mick, they said they'll give me 10 weeks notice about the fights and stuff. But I don't really need 10 weeks. I probably need four weeks. You know, my weight is good. Everything is good. I eat right anyway. You know, I probably need about 4 weeks just to get sharp, get used to the punches, and get the timing and everything right, and some sprints to be explosive. And then I'll be all right, you know.
Is it harder to eat right while all this is going on, when you're stuck around the house quite a lot and you're just kind of bored? Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, but the thing is, luckily for me, I live alone. You know, I live alone. And, you know, going to my mum's house and that, with all the kids there, then that's That's a problem a bit. But because I live alone, it's just about making your surroundings a positive place, making your surroundings a place where you're just like focused on the task at hand, you know, boxing, you focus on boxing, you focus on this and that. And I'm just watching boxing all day or listening to music and just eating healthy all the time, just thinking about the future.
Strangers on Call of Duty.
Yeah.
You've got to keep that killer instinct, haven't you?
Yeah, it's true.
Any way you can. That's good.
Yeah.
It's good to see you in such good spirits.
Yeah, you have to be. You can't really waste your energy being upset, getting mad at something that you can't change. This is happening to everyone. You know, you can't really change what's happened. No. You know, you just have to be committed to the process instead of the results. The results is unfortunately the two fights, you know, after a long time coming, it was going to be good. I sold a lot of tickets. It was going to be great for both shows, you know. But unfortunately, this happened. But, you know, that's not the result. I'm just trusting the process of what's happening. Can you be committed to the process without being emotionally attached to the results of what you want? Do you know what I mean? So no matter what happens, I'm still going to be a hard worker. But if I was committed to the results now, I would have been like, oh, do you know what? I tried and I never got it. I'm feeling upset. No, you just have to keep going. You have to keep going. You have to keep trusting the process. And that's what I've been doing.
Brilliant. Well, I can't wait to come and visit you up in Loughborough once you're all set up there. I've been there before when Dillian White was based there. Facilities are excellent, so it'll be really good.
Thank you very much.
And, yeah, I hope you stay enjoying the rest of lockdown as you seem to be so far. And stay safe.
Sure. I'm not enjoying it, but I'm just, like, getting through it.
Accepting it, making the most of it, I don't know. But yeah, you're taking it in good spirits, yeah. Which is good.
Thank you.
Right, well, I'll see you soon. And stay safe. Yeah. Take care.
All right, boss. Take care.
See you later.